sometimes what we think is a more sustainable alternative to something may not be as sustainable as it sounds, unless used properly. Who would have thought all those emails in my inbox could increase my carbon footprint? So could all those unused tabs that always stay open. But at the same time, who would have thought deleting all those unwanted emails and closing those unused tabs could be a step towards a more sustainable life? And that, indeed, was one of my initial questions when I first started to learn about climate change. What are the small actions I'll be able to do at my age, back when I was 10 or 11, that could have a potential impact? Fast forward, and my organization, which started with a handful of members, today is a thriving organization with members from over 15 countries. But we're still a flower that has just budded as the app development process has just begun. Our organization aims to educate individuals on the seriousness of climate change to equip them with the knowledge necessary to create a tangible difference. Our app will act as a platform where people could get rewards for every environmentally friendly action they do. But what made me want to start a climate organization, as if my little over a million hobbies weren't enough? Even though I was balancing them perfectly. Seriously? I didn't. How could anyone decide between sketching, video editing, and reading? In fifth grade, my curiosity turned into a full-blown obsession. Thanks to a fascinating subject called Unit of Inquiry, or UOI, which is a part of the IB curriculum. Funny enough, I only learned the full form of it recently while drafting the speech. The subject was like a playground where sciences, politics, social studies, and more merged. And every time we dove into an environmental issue, it reignited that initial spark of curiosity in me. But why did the fifth grader Mridula become so fixated on climate, and what was that initial curiosity? Well, blame it on my upbringing. Growing up, I experienced a stark contrast. City life was buzzing and vibrant, but disconnected from the nature. That was a necessity for my parents' business and education. And then there were visits to our family's farm, a world alive with greenery, but facing its own challenges. This contrast sparked a curiosity in me, a desire to understand the environment and how human actions affect it. A few years ago, like most teenagers, I was juggling schools, dreams, and figuring out my place in the world, possibly as a doctor, in the next couple of years. But today, unlike most 17-year-olds, my path did take some interesting twists, fueled by the burning curiosity that followed me ever since. And let me tell you, satisfying that curiosity involves some serious loose mood actions. Talking about twists, quick flashback to 3 years to the past. There came the global lockdown during COVID, school shut down, and the world went online. And bananas, literally with all the extra baking. While most struggled with the shift, I saw an opportunity. No more textbooks, just self-paced learning. Anyway, I was kind of the person who could only truly learn by forming deep connections. Textbooks were never enough. So I dove headfirst into research, devouring information like a kid at a free candy buffet. Or maybe not just quite a kid, because I wouldn't mind doing that for the rest of my life. We're facing a global crisis, yet it falls so distant. Climate change seems like a giant hairy monster under the bed of humanity. Luckily, the internet god smiled upon me, and I stumbled across this YouTube video about an amazing online community for IB students. The community connected me with peers worldwide, fueling my passion for learning and driving my desire to create a tangible difference, which constantly grew stronger. However, I noticed that most environmental efforts seem large-scale, driven by governments and NGOs. Systematic changes are necessary to tackle climate change effectively. But what about individuals? What about us, the average you and me? Do our actions matter? Could our actions really make a difference? That's when the idea of my own organization sprouted. Originally, it was all about planting trees and spreading awareness. Trees are fantastic, don't get me wrong, but thanks to my research rabbit hole, I realized we needed to tackle a much bigger problem than just our carbon dioxide emission. One late night, while seesawing between sleep and one more piece of chocolate from the fridge, my brain decided to surprise me. That's when I had the light bulb moment. Or maybe it was just the fridge light after the late night chocolate run. A vision for an app, a tool to empower individuals to create real impact. We're talking about knowledge fused with tangible actions. Because let's face it, the environment suffers from a million tiny cuts, But a million tiny actions can heal those cuts too. Because after all, we made majority of the cuts. For most of my life, I've lived in Bangalore. Until the beginning of this year, now we shifted to Bangalore. Beginning, we were in Coimbatore. And today, I'm standing in this beautiful land of Goa for my first ever TEDx talk. But one of the things I was able to notice right off the bat was the weather. While I was getting boiled alive in Coimbatore, I couldn't stand anyone turning on the fan in the hall without being frozen in Bangalore. Goa's Goa, though, the one I had always imagined in my head, nice and warm, with a bit of a rain. A few parts of India has been pouring rain, while a few others are experiencing heat waves. But the thing is, you may have the privilege to fly to a safer place when the extreme weather events go out of hand, leading to floods or heat strokes. But can you escape from the climate? The answer is an enormous no, not even a century's worth of fortune. But why is that? To understand, let's quickly break down the difference between climate and weather. In simple terms, climate refers to the long-term patterns of the weather condition in a particular region over many, many years. As a wise old grandma, consistent and dependable with a long memory. Weather, on the other hand, refers to the day-to-day or short-term atmospheric conditions, such as temperature, precipitation, humidity, etc. Think of weather as your moody teenager. One minute they're blasting sunshine and reggae, and the next they're throwing a tantrum with thunders and downpours. In essence, climate is a long-term average of weather, while weather represents the current or short-term atmospheric conditions. I can ask my friend how the weather is, not how the climate is. But why do we need to care about the environment? Talking about climate and weather, what are these actually? Seems like an issue of the environment, right? Well, not really. This was how I was drawn further into digging deeper about climate change. As someone who wants to grow up to become a doctor, I dug into how the harms we do to our Earth directly or indirectly affects us as well. Everything in this world, I mean every single thing, is connected with the environment in one way or the other. Do you think climate change can revive centuries-old zombie pathogens? Melting of permafrost, the permanently frozen ground in cold region, is a consequence of rising global temperature. This releases long-dormant pathogens which have been trapped in the ice for hundreds and thousands of years, and our bodies pose no defense against them. So this could end with endless of pandemics. It's always the small actions that lead to bigger effects. This can be further seen clearly by looking into feedback loops. Life systems rely on it, from the smallest biological processes within our body to the largest ecological systems. Sweating to regulate body temperature, which is a negative feedback loop, and ripening of fruit, accelerating the ripening of nearby fruits, which is a positive feedback loop. Negative feedback loop keep things balanced, while positive feedback loops accelerate change. Take something simple like heat. As the Earth warms, ice melts, revealing a darker land of surface beneath. This absorbs more heat, which speeds up warming. But wait, more heat also brings in more clouds, which can reflect off some sunlight and cool things down for a bit. This is a negative feedback loop. But this isn't a solution. Heat waves still cause health problems, and rising sea levels threaten coastal communities. Negative feedback loops are never a fix to the real problem. The real problem is our greenhouse gas emission. And to fix that, we as individuals should start being mindful of all our actions. But here's the good news. Most of these changes are caused by us, which means we have the power to reverse them. So take on your capes and wear them proudly so you'd be part of the solution, not the problem. Learning about climate is the first line of defense. So keep reading and spreading what you learn. But who says fighting climate change has to be such a drag? We all know the big hitters, ditching solo car trips for public transport, saying no to fast fashion, recycling, and all. But here's the surprising one. Did you know even tiny digital habits can make a difference? Lowering your screen brightness and closing unnecessary tabs might seem insignificant, but studies show collectively how these actions could significantly reduce the energy consumption in data centers. Crazy, right? So the next time you're decluttering your inbox, remember you're not just decluttering your digital life, you're contributing to a greener planet. And for every 1,000 unwanted email deletion, you're saving up to 5 grams of CO2 emission from your side. These are micro actions with macro benefits, and that is a today I'll learn moment worth sharing. Look, I'm 17. At this age, life seems endless. But with the average lifespan of 75 years, the world I will be living in as an adult is shaped by our choices right now. And to be honest, that can be a scary thought. But let me tell you, the future does not have to be a dystopian nightmare. We have all seen what a global crisis can do. Remember the lockdown a few years ago? The earth paused and the nature responded. Cleaner air, clearer water, even wildlife returning. Earth's resilience is powerful. A glimpse of what we can do if we work together. But pandemic shouldn't be a trigger for healing. That's why I started taking action 7 years ago, driven by my curiosity. When did you first realize your actions matter? Because it's never too late. Every one of us, regardless of age, holds the pen. And climate change is writing the history books of the future. We are the authors, and the story is still being written. Let's rewrite the story of the future together. Every small action counts. Thank you.